Some of you can remember the days when racial segregation was a very stark divide in this nation. If you traveled in the Deep South, you remember seeing drinking fountains and restrooms with whites-only signs in front of them. There were hotels and restaurants and public golf courses and many other facilities that you were not allowed in if you were not white. It wasn't all in the Deep South, however. There were pockets of segregations in towns and cities in various parts of this nation. Many public schools around the nation were segregated decades after laws officially ended segregation. We are glad to be able to say that those days of that stark segregation are gone from our society. The trouble is, there is still prejudice and hatred in groups of people in our land. Some of it is still racial, but there are other kinds of prejudice as well. The division between Jews and Samaritans were wide, and the animosity, even outright hatred, ran very deep. Unless we understand the tension between Jews and Samaritans, we miss the very dramatic aspect of this conversation between Jesus and the Samaritan woman in John 4. Here is a brief summary of who the Samaritans are and why they and the Jews had such animosity toward one another. By going to Samaria and bringing the gospel to the despised Samaritans, Jesus showed that he was above the prejudices that Jews had toward Samaritans. Where did these prejudices come from? Samaria was a region between Judea and Galilee, where Jews of mixed blood lived. In the Old Testament days, when the northern kingdom of Israel and its capital at Samaria fell to the Assyrians, many Jews were deported to Assyria. King Sargon of Assyria repopulated the northern kingdom with captives from other lands. They settled in the territory to keep the peace. You read about it, by the way, in 2 Kings chapter 17. These captives eventually intermarried with the few Jews who remained in the land to form a mixed race of people who became known as Samaritans. The Jews hated the Samaritans because they were no longer pure Jews. The Jews who lived in the southern kingdom felt like these Jews in the north had betrayed their people and nation through intermarriage with foreigners, which was strictly prohibited in the Old Testament. Their hatred continued down through the years. When the remnant of Jews returned from captivity in Babylon, they refused the Samaritans living in the land any participation in the rebuilding of the temple or the city of Jerusalem, even though the Samaritans claimed to have the same God as the Jews. See Ezra chapter 4 for a discussion of that. They called the Samaritans enemies. Smarting under this repulse, they turned bitterly against the Jews in Jerusalem. That was about 450 BC when the quarrel took place, and it was as bitter as ever almost 500 years later in the days of Jesus. So you think the hard feelings of the people in the Deep South about the Civil War are running a long time? Look again. Here's 500 years of division and animosity. Let's go to verse 9 of this passage in chapter 4. The Samaritan woman said to Jesus, "How is it that you, a Jew, ask a drink of me, a woman of Samaria?" The Samaritan woman was very surprised. First, that a Jew would even speak to a Samaritan. Second, that a Jewish male would speak to a Samaritan woman. She had, by the way, a bad reputation, and this was a public place. Third, she was surprised that a Jew would drink from a Samaritan's cup. Do you remember the days of segregation when people would not drink from the cup that someone of another race had partaken? So this visits our culture and our society and our world. The Jews did not share things in common with Samaritans. And it was a surprise indeed that Jesus sought out this woman at the well and began, of all things, a conversation with her. Julian had the privilege years ago of working with Jim Moore, one of the great preachers of the United Methodist Church. Wonderful storyteller. Jim tells a story about a fellow minister who he has a deep appreciation for. Jim says, his name is Tom, and he does a fascinating thing each month. Even though he has an extremely busy schedule because he's pastor of one of the finest churches in our nation, still he takes the time each month to go down to the homeless shelter in his city and work in their soup kitchen. After the homeless people have been fed, he then invites them to join him in a service of Holy Communion. Many of them come with him to the little chapel in the homeless shelter, and they join together in the sacrament of the Lord's Supper. They've shared soup together in the soup kitchen. Then they come and share the bread and the cup together at the altar in the chapel. One day, Tom had an unforgettable experience at the communion service in the homeless shelter. He was moving down the altar after serving communion, and he came on a man kneeling who looked like he'd been out on the streets for quite a while. The man looked up at Tom and whispered, "Skip me." "What? Pardon me?" Tom said. In a louder whisper, the man said again, "Skip me." "Why?" Tom asked. "Because," the man said, "I'm not worthy." What was Tom's response? "Neither am I." Then Tom added, "I'll tell you what. I'm going to serve communion to these other people. Then I'm going to come back and serve communion to you. And then I would like you to serve communion to me." The man blinked and said to Tom, "Father, is it legal?" "Yes, it's legal. It's beautiful, and that's what we're going to do," Tom responded. Tom went down the altar and served all the other people who were kneeling there, and then he came back to the reluctant man. He said, "What's your name?" The man said, "Josh." Tom placed the elements of the Lord's Supper before him and said, "Josh, here is the body of Christ, and here is the blood of Christ given for you. Eat this and drink this in remembrance that Christ came for you and Christ died for you." Josh blinked back the tears that were in his eyes. He received Holy Communion. Then Tom knelt and handed Josh the trays of bread and wine and said, "Now, you serve me." Josh took the trays, and again he said, "Father, are you sure this is legal?" Josh's eyes were darting from side to side as he looked over this shoulder and then the other, and as if he expected at any moment the police or the FBI or the CIA or the Pope to come rushing in and arrest him. Finally, he held the trays toward Tom, and as Tom received the sacrament, Josh muttered, "Body, blood for you. Hang in there." Tom later said, "Of all the communion rituals that I've ever heard, I don't recall the words 'hang in there' in any of them. But that moment for me, Holy Communion had never been more holy." Josh walked out of the homeless shelter that day with an extra spring in his step. It was reported that he went everywhere saying, "You won't believe what I did today." In fact, the story became so widespread that from that day, Josh became known in the streets as the Rev. What a remarkable story this is. A story of grace, a story of love and acceptance and forgiveness and reconciliation and bridge building and Holy Communion. Interesting, this story reminds us of the powerful passage in John 4, which records Jesus' encounter with the Samaritan woman at the well. That too was a moment of amazing grace and Holy Communion. This woman too, like Josh, felt unworthy. She too wasn't sure that this encounter with Jesus was legal. She too was accustomed to being sneered at, talked about, looked down upon, cast out. Society had not been kind to her. She'd had 5 husbands. She was presently living with a man out of wedlock, prompting some scholars to suggest that she was a promiscuous woman. Others to surmise that she'd been a victim of a society because in those days, it was the husband who pronounced the divorce, meaning this woman, in one way or another, had been discarded 5 times. Whatever the case, one thing was clear. She was an outcast. She had a bad reputation. And still, Jesus reached out to her in love and compassion. In much the same way as Nicodemus, the Samaritan woman does not grasp what Jesus is telling her about himself and about this gift of living water that he offers her. When Jesus told Nicodemus that he must be born again, this wise and highly educated Pharisee asked Jesus how he could enter his mother's womb and be born a second time. The Samaritan woman is just as confused about what Jesus meant by living water. But there is one all-important difference. Despite her confusion about what Jesus means, this woman is open to receiving what Jesus is offering. She says to him in verse 15, "Sir, give me this water that I may never be thirsty or have to keep coming here to draw water." She's ready to receive what God so compassionately offers. But that's just part of the story. In reading this passage about the Samaritan woman, and especially the part that Judy just read to you, where Jesus so directly confronts this woman, I used to think that Jesus was very abrupt, even mean to her in their conversation. Knowing what he did about the tensions between Jews and Samaritans, knowing what he knew about this poor woman, was it really necessary for Jesus to taunt the Samaritan woman about her personal life? Why, according to John's account, does Jesus move so abruptly from talking about the living water to talking about her personal sin? King Duncan, another great storyteller, tells a story about a man who wanted forgiveness but without repentance. Man had been working for a lumber yard for some 25 years. During that time, whenever he wanted lumber, he helped himself to it. In fact, he had stolen so much lumber that he became the richest man in the town. He became so rich and prominent, in fact, that he was made a deacon in his local Baptist church. Oh, goody, we get to talk about the Baptists. This worried him because he felt he could not serve as a deacon with this terrible sin on his conscience. One night, as he pitched and tossed in bed, And the thought occurred to him that he could sneak over and talk to the local Catholic priest about it. The priest said it was a bit unusual for a Baptist to come to confession, but he would be glad to hear him. After the man told the priest about stealing all of the lumber, he said, "You know, this thing they say about confession being good for the soul is right. I never felt so relieved in my life. Is that all there is to it?" "Why, no," said the priest. "You can't lie and steal and lead a life of sin for 25 years and come down here and talk to me for 30 minutes and wipe the slate clean. You got to do something to make it right with the Lord." "Did you ever make amends?" the priest asked. "No, I never did one of those," said the man. "But if you've got the plans, I can get the lumber." Repentance is very important. Whether we do it in a confessional act, as the Catholics do in confessing their sin, or whether it's a very personal thing built deep into our heart and conscience, we can't really receive the forgiveness of God until that repentance, that authentic sense of having done wrong, begins to work in us. Needless to say, something deeper, something more life-changing happened within the Samaritan woman after her conversation with Jesus. William Barclay captures what happens in the second part of the conversation between Jesus and the Samaritan. He entitles it, "Facing the Truth." He has a great way of summing up the impact of this later part of the conversation after it's over. He identifies four changes that begin to happen within the Samaritan woman. By this time, the woman was on her way back to the village without her water pot. The fact that she left her water pot shows two things. It shows that she was in a hurry to share this extraordinary experience. It shows that she had never dreamed of doing anything else but coming back. Her whole action was much to tell us of real Christian experience, forgiveness with repentance. Her experience began with being compelled to face herself and to see herself as she really is. The same thing happened to Peter. After the draught of the fishes, Peter suddenly discovered something of the majesty of Jesus. All he could say was, "Depart from me, for I am a sinful man, O Lord." That from Luke 5. Our Christian experience will often begin with a humiliating wave of self-disgust. It usually happens that the last thing a man sees is himself. It often happens that the first thing that Christ does for a man is to compel him to do what he has spent his life refusing to do. Look long and hard so that he really sees himself. The Samaritan woman was staggered by Christ's ability to see into her innermost being. She was amazed at his intimate knowledge of her heart. Of her heart in particular, the psalmist was awed by the same thought, "Thou discernest my thoughts from afar. Even before a word is on my tongue, O Lord, thou knowest it altogether." That, of course, from Psalm 139. Once a small girl heard a sermon by the great preacher C.H. Spurgeon. She whispered to her mother at the end of it, "Mom, how does he know what goes on in our house? There are no wrappings or disguises which are proof against the gaze of Christ." Sometimes we do feel like the word of the Lord in Scripture, or perhaps a word from a Christian friend, is God talking to us. Christ's power to see the depths of the human heart not only sees the evil there, he also sees what can be the sleeping hero in the soul of every man, as Barclay puts it. He's like the surgeon who sees the disease thing, but he also sees the health which will follow if the evil thing is taken away. The first instinct of the Samaritan woman was to share her discovery. Having found this amazing person, she's compelled to share what she has found with others. A Christian life is based on the twin pillars of discovery and communication. No discovery is complete until the desire to share it begins to fill our hearts. That indeed is a work of the Holy Spirit. We cannot communicate what Christ has done for us until we have discovered him for ourselves. First to find, then to tell. These are the two great steps of the Christian life. This very desire to tell others of her discovery killed in this woman the feeling of shame. She was so full of the desire to share this transforming thing that had happened that she left her shame like the water pot at the well. She was no doubt an outcast. She was no doubt a word sneered at when people talked about her. The very fact that she was drawing water from this distant well showed that she avoided her neighbors and how they avoided her. But now she ran to tell them of her discovery. A person may have trouble with which he is embarrassed to mention when he tries to keep a secret. But once the secret is out, once he is cured, he is often so filled with wonder and gratitude that he wants to tell everyone about it. We can sum up the conversation between Jesus and the woman about this proper place of worship with the following reflection, which comes from the Life Application Commentary on John chapter 4. Do you depend on a physical building or a specific setting as a proper place to worship? God is spirit and cannot be confined to a building. The location of worship is not nearly as important as the attitude of the worshiper. The specific conditions that enhance worship tend to be quite individual and should not be legislated. By emphasizing where we worship, we may neglect the substance of our worship where we are. Worship begins with an attitude on our part, an attitude of being open, an attitude of discovering by the work of the Holy Spirit what God wants us to see and hear and experience. That's why for us, for Julian and I and others, all aspects of worship are so important. The music is important. The prayers are important. The fellowship that we have with each other are important. And the testimony we have to give about what God is doing in our lives is most important of all. Some people call the Samaritan woman the first evangelist in the New Testament. She went and told the entire town. And do you notice what they said? They sounded like they were from Missouri, didn't they? They said, "We don't take her word for it. We have come to see for ourselves." That's why the popular saying, "God has no grandchildren, only children." Each of us must experience his life-saving work for ourselves. Let us pray. Lord, we thank you for this tremendous and moving and in some ways for us mysterious conversation. We thank you that Jesus crossed barriers, that he disregarded the places others would not go. We thank you that he helped the Samaritan woman to face the truth so that the truth he offered could set her free. We would pray the same for us. and those we love. In our Lord Jesus, we pray. Amen.